Hey guys, it's Tom from Ignite. Today we're going to be talking about William Faulkner's As I Lay Dying, his 1930 novel, and particularly we're going to be focusing on some of the key themes that he talks about, getting into them, analyzing them. Make sure if you like this content that you subscribe to the channel and click the bell for notifications so you can see all our other videos that we've done. Essentially, what I'm going to be talking about today is a couple of key themes, but they all center on this main idea of disintegration. Essentially, this novel, As I Lay Dying, centers on what I think is a crisis of disintegration. You have that, obviously, in terms of a literal thing in the plot of the novel. What we're talking about is trying to move the body of this matriarch from one county to another and the family's journey throughout. So you have the sort of physical disintegration in the sense of the matriarch and her, you know, decomposing body that they're trying to move, that sort of moves along the plot of this novel. But disintegration obviously is kind of the central metaphor of the text because it refracts back through a lot of the sort of social and economic points that Faulkner is trying to make. The disintegration of institutions, of previous structures, of class delineations. So let's get into those. We're going to start firstly with the collapse of institutions, as I've mentioned. So I've broken this down into three different kind of central pillars of life in the South that Faulkner was writing through. So this sort of shift we see in capitalism. Firstly, we see the sort of the onset of modern capitalism. So we see not only in terms of kind of banks and loans being formalized and more regulated by the government, but seeing in sort of more sort of complex bond structures and things like that that get people into kind of debt and wage slavery, which is kind of a big issue that was going through the agrarian South. You also see that more in terms of simply the tide of economic progress that was sweeping through the South as well. So in terms of the mechanization of a lot of farming structures and the modernization of society. And you can see the way that Faulkner is in some sense bumping against this progressive change, the winds of progressive change, and calling back on a kind of nostalgia about the South and about sort of the unit of the family and about what that represents and how that's going to survive as we sort of move forward into modernity. And that's a theme that I think resonates still today and is a good way of linking Faulkner's context to our modern context in our analysis as well. Secondly, we're going to talk about the government, so the way that the collapse of institutions refracts through the government. So this was a time of massive expansion for the American government that Faulkner was writing against, but at the same time, this is a time of a crisis of faith in a lot of what the government's role could be. And you see that in the wake of World War I and sort of massive death tolls there, but the US is sort of burgeoning imperialism and the way that it interacts with the world around them. There is sort of this contradiction in some sense between the mythology of the United States and the mythology of the government with sort of in practice how these people were living, particularly people who were living kind of on the outskirts, on the margins of society, particularly in an economic way. And you notice that in terms of, this is written in 1930, so in the midst of the Great Depression and the way that particularly that had a massive impact on a lot of wage workers in the agrarian South, on farms, and particularly the way that they sort of refracted that economic angst. And you can see the way that comes through in a lot of the literary work at that time, particularly the way that Faulkner was in tune with a lot of that. And finally, in terms of religions, this sort of links back to the family unit and the kind of nostalgia I was talking about, but the way that in terms of the growth of modernism and sort of secular thought, these are contradicting vectors that clash, and you find them within this text, that the sort of the mythology of a lot of religious figures is contradicted by their actual practice. You see this in terms of the disputed parentage of Jule Bundren and the way that links back to the Reverend and this kind of understanding of both the holiness and the unholiness of sort of modern religious institutions. The second theme we're going to talk about is faith, death, and existence, so pretty small stuff. But basically, this is explored in this text in a number of different ways, I think most clearly seen through, again, these kind of this disintegrating ideas of what is true, what is objective, into these splintering kind of subjective thoughts. And I think Faulkner tends to explore this most prominently through Vardaman, who's the youngest member of the Bundren family. But he's the member that it seems is most apt to sort of fall into these existential crises that sort of puncture a lot of the sort of propriety that we see in sort of the adults and a lot of their carrying on. And Vardaman seems to be the person that sort of draws them back into understanding these grander themes, which is ironic for somebody who's the youngest member of the family. But for instance, in you notice one of the scenes in which he is cutting up a fish for a meal, I believe, and he's sort of unable to distinguish that fish that he is eating from the fish that he had caught prior, and he sort of doesn't understand these different phases of existence and how they can coincide. And this refracts back to a lot of the stuff we were talking about in terms of stream of consciousness that we spoke about in the form video that you can find in our channel as well, and the way that as much as faith and death and existence are kind of confused, Faulkner is deliberately doing that in the way that he will make a non-linear storytelling. He'll jump between narrators and he'll do it in a stream of consciousness style that is designed to kind of obfuscate from some sort of central truth. And he does that in a lot of his other work, The Sound and the Fury as well, as another novel that is worth checking out, that he employs a very similar tactic in that. So the final theme we're going to talk about is poverty in the South. I touched on this earlier, and particularly you notice this in terms of what would be an economic or Marxist analysis of this text. You'll see a lot of mention of poverty in the South coming through, particularly the way that this family unit sort of finds itself in the hierarchy of society. So we see obviously the sort of the sweeping change of modernity and modernism coming through, and the way that the family has to attempt to navigate those. You see this particularly, I think, early on in the novel, in the way that the family is interacting with other members of society, the way that they're trying to sort of present themselves as equals, but sort of struggling to do so by virtue of their economic class. You see that money is often the medium that kind of mediates different interactions in the South. And you find this is sort of money is a proxy for power in this society in a way that gets very confusing with those traditional conceptions of religion and family hierarchy and the way that you notice contradictions. So I think particularly you notice this when, for instance, Jewel purchases a pony with the money that has accumulated, and this kind of challenges the patriarchal authority that previously vested in the parents, and the way that how money can sort of mess up the previous power dynamics. And I think you see that sort of filter through a lot of the analysis, and it's really important to touch on that theme, on poverty, and the way that it is made into some kind of metaphor for a grander power scheme and the point that Faulkner is trying to make there. So those are the themes that I really think are the three most important themes in As I Lay Dying, and that any analysis should really delve into at least two of those, to be really touching on them in a sort of substantial way and linking those in with form and context. So thanks very much for watching, guys. Remember, if you like this video, please subscribe to our content and you can keep watching our other videos on different novels and others in this series. Thanks very much.
Hey guys, thank you so much for watching. If you do like the content, subscribe to our channel and we'll have more videos coming your way.
That's right, guys. Thanks for watching. And please make sure you check out our online resource database. We've had a team of state rank achievers and heads of English put these together for you, covering everything from essay structures and examples all the way through to craft of writing and comprehension skills. So check them out at ignitehse.com.au, and we look forward to seeing you in the next video.